simultaneously the book of Romans. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, all God's people said,
Amen.
Father, we ask your blessing and we thank you for this time and the word of God and the teachings of the church. And we ask your blessing upon us, Lord, that we can understand how to be saved and come into a living relationship with Yeshua HaMashiach. Bless this word to us, Lord. May it enlighten our hearts. May we find joy in the salvation in Jesus Christ alone. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, all God's people said,
Amen.
Now, when we look at Galatians 3 tonight, you're saved by grace alone. Amen?
Yes.
Turn to the person next to you and say, you're saved by grace alone.
You're saved by grace alone.
Now turn to the person next to you and say, you can't earn it.
You can't earn it.
Okay, how many have ever tried to earn your salvation?
No.
Really, when you're on your deathbed, I don't want you saying, oh, no, I wasn't good enough. I wasn't good enough. Okay, that doesn't bring your salvation. It's living your faith. You know, everyone says upstairs, oh, it's a great job, great job. But you got to have faith and grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
Now you get to the last second to make a decision for Christ. I don't recommend it. I recommend, as the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 6, today is the day of salvation. I recommend on Friday, Monica, we're going to pray with all the kids to meet Jesus as their personal Lord and their personal Savior. So we're going to have all the kids come into a living relationship with Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen?
Amen.
So now, Paul gets really perturbed here. Galatia, it was the area of Turkey, and he gets upset with them because they're going backwards. Anybody ever see anybody go spiritually backwards?
Yes. Yes.
In the book of, what does it mean when we go backwards? When we resist the Holy Spirit, we go backwards. When we resist God's plan for us. Let's see, how many would like to find out if you're going backwards?
Yeah.
All right? I will share with you if you're going backwards. Don't tell the person next to you. They'll be on you. Or maybe that you should. If your spirituality was here, you were really growing in God, and you're doing less than what you used to do, you're going backwards. If you were here, you should be here, growing and growing and growing. So if you're going backwards, come on. Let's change the course right now. So Paul is really upset they're going backwards. Everybody with me in Galatians 3. He says, oh foolish people of foolish Galatians. Remember how to say fool in Greek? Morons. How many of Paul was quite angry? Oh, you morons of Middletown. How many would be insulted?
Yeah.
Nobody?
Yeah.
Imagine if you heard preaching up there, especially with the usher standing in the back row. Oh, you morons standing up in the back row there. Amen. How many would be insulted? Okay. So notice he says, oh, foolish Galatians. Now, you've been so trained in trying to earn your way to heaven. Even though I'm sharing with us this great note, but how many know back down there in that mind of yours, you're still thinking of how to earn it? And how many know it's going to kill you? Then you go backwards. Then is it good enough? And then I say, are you saved? I don't know about that. Then how many know what we love to do in this room? Practice false humility. How many do that all the time? You love false humility. Oh, Jesus, we save you. I don't know about that. Ay, ay, ay. All right, underline that. Who has bewitched you? Who has bedeviled you? Who has told you this lie? Now remember, if you underline that, who bewitches us all the time? The evil one, doesn't he? Now, what is the whole source of your being bewitched? Deceit. Now, what Satan uses from Genesis chapter 3, he still uses the deceit message. Didn't God really say that to you? You don't have to do that. How many ever heard that one before? And so what Satan was setting them up for deceit. Because what Satan does, he loves to pack with a little truth but lots of lies behind it. Who's bewitched you? Where did you hear this from? You are leading the path. You know that by grace you're saved. Grace alone saves you. Did you know that's Orthodox Catholic belief? How many have really heard that pounded to you in your whole life? Nobody, right? By grace alone you are saved. That means you can't earn it. That means God's life comes through you. That means Jesus lives his life through you. Because there's two forces. You're either saved by grace, God's life, or you got to be saved by the law. How many would love to be saved by the law? That means from this night forward, you got to obey 613 laws perfectly. Anybody think you could do it? We don't even know what they are, let alone... How many know we can't do the 10? How many know we can't do the 2? Love everybody? Come on! Everybody? Bless those who persecute you? Rewrite the book! And you see, grace brings you into life and impossibilities. Life brings you into, ready? Invisibilities. So when you're a believer in Jesus, you live in impossibilities and you live in invisibilities. Wow! Wow! What we can do in the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's do it. Let's yield to God. So everyone's gonna, when you stand before God, you're gonna go on one of these. Am I saved by grace? Or am I saved by the law? And you know what? I work with the Jewish people and they say to me, you got it easy. I said, why? They said, you have Jesus in you. I said, well, you could have him too. They said, no. I said, well, suffer. Who has bewitched you? How come you go backwards? And how many have seen that in your sons and daughters? So raised in the faith, and now you wouldn't know. They're like pagans, some of your kids. Amen? Yeah. Not all of you said amen. That's all right. Before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly betrayed as crucified. Jesus died once and once for all. He was publicly humiliated. Now, when Jesus calls you, you've got to be publicly called. Monica, follow me! You got to say in front of everybody, yes!
That's right.
If you're a disciple of Jesus, you got to go public. And right now we're in public days, right?
Yeah.
I believe what the Holy Spirit's doing in this day, he's going to separate the men from the boys, the girls from the women, who are really going to follow him.
Mm-hmm.
And you might even be surprised. Somebody in here might say, I'm not going to do it. That's for me and my house. Number two, what else is public? What else is public, as Paul says in Colossians? He nailed our sins. Your sins were public on the cross. Every one of your sins was public. Jesus says to us in Luke chapter 12, your sins are going to be exposed if you don't confess them now. If you confess them now, they're forgotten. Let's get them forgotten, amen? I don't want anybody to know my business. I don't want anybody to know my dirty laundry. One day I woke up in beautiful Newark and I discovered my laundry was all over the place. I said to myself, self, you had a bad night. Somebody was in my room robbing me. And they stole my dungarees. And so guess what? Somebody bought me a new pair of dungarees and it was about this big. I said, oh boy, I better lose. The third thing that's going public. Number one, your call is public. Number two, Jesus is public, exposed on the cross. Number three, your sins are public. Number four, what else is public? When Jesus comes to the second coming, that's public. That is public. And guess what? Number five, what's the next thing that's going to be public? We're going to all stand in front of God.
Mm-hmm.
Every single person on the general resurrection, John 5, everybody is going to be public. We're going to look over. Jesus is going to say, God forbid to any of our family, I don't know you. And that's the last time, if you are a redeemed person, you will ever cry. So underline the word public. Those are the things going public.
These days are here.
These days are here. That's public.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus calls you. Jesus is exposed. Your sins are exposed. The coming of the Lord, it will be public. The judgment day will be public. Everything is out in front. Guess what? We're going to find out about each other. Oh my heavens. This man needs to repent. This man needs to get back with God. Yes, sir.
So we have, when we die, we have the private judgment, right?
You have the partial judgment, yes.
Right.
You know immediately when you die whether you're going to heaven or hell.
Right. And then when we go to heaven, hell, or purgatory, then we have the general judgment at the end of
yes.
So then we judge twice.
No, you judge once whether where your destiny is. The second judgment, which is called the corporeal judgment, where you'll be your state in glory. You see, when you go to heaven, everybody here will not be in the same state of heaven. You can be. You want to have a better heaven? Live better for the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11 to 16. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 3, 11 to 16, you're going to have a system of rewards. We all graduate. Bum, 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 bum. Did we all graduate? But what happens at graduation? Did everybody here become the valedictorian?
No.
Salutatorian, whatever they call everything? How many ever got mad? And now, for the 20th time, John Doe gets the honor. I'm like, share with somebody else, like me. How many get mad when the same person gets called 4 or 5 times? You go, I got nothing. I just get to throw this cap up in the air and say, get them out of here, amen? We all graduated. You all got your diploma. But some of us did better than others. So we all, by faith in Jesus Christ, we're all saved. We get into heaven. We all got it right. But some of us live for the Lord better than others. 1 Corinthians 3, 11 to 16 says, you'll be rewarded accordingly. Right? Amen? And if you boast of your rewards, guess what happens to your reward? Oh, you know what I did today? I gave $1,000. Oh, you're so wonderful. Then I stand in front of God. God, remember in July I gave you $1,000? Yeah, they clapped for you. That was your reward. Oh, darn. Okay, because I boasted of what I did. And you all said, yeah, I was wonderful. I wanted human praise instead of God's praise. And so guess what happens? It's gone. That's what it means. It'll be burnt up. And how do you say burnt up in Greek? Pur. Okay, amen? Yes. Next, he says there, let me ask you, verse 2. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? Now, everybody underline the next question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? This is the first century expression, are you born again? Now, we've been raised not hearing that term, are you born again? How many ever heard it? Did anybody come up to you, are you a born again Christian? Yeah. What should we respond? Hopefully, yes. I do accept Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. Amen? So if someone says, are you saved? Yes, I'm saved. I'm being saved because Jesus is still working on me. I will be saved because I'll be in a box. And on the last day, I get lifted. Amen? How many know I get a facelift? And a body lift. Amen? So, box in there. This is the first century expression, are you a born again Christian? Did you receive the Holy Spirit? In the first century, did they not go around and say, are you a born-again Christian? Remember, they thought they were very much still in the very, very, very beginning as what? Fulfilled Jews. They thought they were fulfilled Jews. So if you hear the expression, are you a born-again Christian? How many know the born-again Christian terminology is the late 19th, early 20th century? You know why that happened? Because the Germans, we have ways of making you think, the Germans were going around saying, and the French, what a combination, they're going around saying, the Bible's not true. They were make-believe stories. There's no such thing as Adam and Eve. Job, forget it, nice little story. How many have ever heard that preaching, there's little stories? Would you do that? Would you knock them out in Christian love? Just knock them out in Christian love, amen? Everything is in Christian love. The Bible is absolutely true. Amen? So what happens then is they went around in that part of the century and said, we're born again. So when you have these denominations and these on fire beliefs, you've got to be a born again Christian. They said, what's that? I go to church every Sunday. Oh, you're not saved. Right? So, and that's what confused you growing up. And I hear all of you saying to me all the time, you know, My nephew is a born-againer. So, a born-againer? You're making up more terminology, a born-againer. I said, well, I'm born again. I'm born again, Bible-believing, evangelical, spirit-filled, New Testament, Catholic, Christian church, a living God, D, all of the above. I believe in a living relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? That he is the Savior for all people to come to a relationship with him. Amen? So, do I love him? Absolutely. Do I need him? Absolutely. So, underline that. Paul would say, did you receive the Holy Spirit? Now, go with me, please. Hold your spot. Make a left into the book of Acts. Now, did you receive the Holy Spirit? So, reception of the Holy Spirit is pivotal. Now, look at your life growing up. How many here, now be honest, you're in church, but below the church, but you're in church. How many ever heard about the Holy Spirit a whole lot?
No.
I got so excited about the Holy Spirit when I found out he was real. I went, whoa, is he real? Go to Acts 19, please. Acts 19. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? So this is the expression, are you a born-again Christian of the first century? Remember, they thought they were very Jews. Paul never thought for one minute that he left Judaism. St. Peter. Peter, we just found out last week, Peter did what? He ministered to who?
The Jews.
I think he's a little bit timid because Paul knew all these different languages all over the globe. You see, when you lived in Palestine, did you travel a lot much?
No.
And Jesus did not float to India. Ay, what nonsense, yeah. I'm hearing. Mm-hmm. He just went to Sidon and Tyre to, why? Because that was witchy poo area. There's a lady who had a demonized daughter. What did he do? He heard the cry across the border. He walks across the border and the lady says, look, treat me like a little dog. If you get a little crumb, heal my daughter. Matthew chapter 15. And from that moment on, do you know what happened? No more kosher laws. We don't have to obey kosher laws. How many know we look like we don't obey kosher laws? If you go to Acts 19, we're looking for the expression, did you receive the Holy Spirit? Amen? Acts 19. Everybody with me in Acts 19?
Yeah.
Who wrote Acts? St. Luke. Well, Apollos was at Corinth. Now, Paul spent a year and a half there. Remember, we did Corinthians. And Corinthians was a lot of activity, but not a lot of spirituality. I'm so glad. You know, I check all the bulletins on all the surrounding churches. This church is alive.
Yeah.
And we have even spies coming from others to visit us now. Colt's neck. Now, Apollos was at Corinth. Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus. Ephesus was a queen city. It was a vanity fair. It was really getting all the trade. And when I'm watching Greece on the news these days, I heard the word Thessalonica. I went, oh. And I just saw one man, just an old gent, just totally collapsed on the street, just fell down. He says, you know, my pension's gone, I don't have any money. So Ephesus was there. And of course, we have the book of Ephesians there. There he said to some, found some disciples. So Paul's getting excited, do you know the Lord Jesus? But guess what? They didn't know the Holy Spirit. Do you know where I drive people nuts? I love the Holy Spirit in their life. We don't want the Holy Spirit. We just like our simple way of life. But when you see Monica bouncing with the kids, Monica looks like she has the Holy Spirit out there. Amen.
Amen.
So, amen. So we got it. And she wears these Google glasses and everything. Anyway. So everybody underline that. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? That's the first century expression. Are you born again? Now, would you like to go home and ask all the people there, did they receive the Holy Spirit? Just do it. Watch the reaction.
Did the Jews believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes. They believe in a force of God. They don't believe in the Trinity.
They believe in the Holy Spirit.
They believe it all goes with God in one.
All goes with God in one. Okay.
Like His Spirit. They do believe in the Ruach, R-U-A-C-H, Ruach. Ruach.
Ruach.
Okay, make sure this is not being taped the wrong way. All right. Now, underline there verse number two. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Now, when you believe, do you have the Holy Spirit in you? Yes. Faith in God allows the Holy Spirit to operate. When you have the Holy Spirit working through you, then you do the things of God. All right, did you hear what I said? When you have the Holy Spirit, you do the things of God. When you have the Holy Spirit, you are compelled by that Spirit to operate in the Holy Spirit. Okay, everybody following? Now, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, then you're not doing the things of God. What mass are you going to? Let's get it over with. I hope it's not Father Bill and I get at it. then there's no transformation. You look robotic. You look mechanic. Right? Did you receive the Holy Spirit? Imagine if you and I were asked this all the time. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? So the Holy Spirit is the power of God having us live in the power of God so that we can really look like Jesus. Amen? Now, so Paul says, oh, you people of Middletown, you're foolish! How can you go back? How can you have had Jesus? How can you have rubbed shoulders with Jesus and heard all the truth of the gospel and not have anything be changed in your life? Amen?
Amen.
I like what Paul says in Hebrews 5. You're dull! Dull, dull, dull! How many are dull in here? Ask the person next to you, are you dull?
No.
What does it mean to be dull? To be dull in Hebrews chapter 5, to be dull means you can't hear. You can't hear. When the word of God is preached and you're invited into the newness of God, you don't do anything with it. You're dull, baby. Dull. Amen?
Amen.
So how many want to live in grace? Or you want to be dull? You want to look like this for the rest of your life? That's dull. Amen? How many need a little excitement? And you don't even have to do a carnival cruise. This is a life in the Spirit. Amen? Amen. Yes?
Isn't that why we're sheep? Because they're the dumbest animal.
You got it. All right, back with me, chapter 3 of Galatians. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by works of the law? Can you receive the Holy Spirit by works of the law?
Yeah.
How many laws are there?
613.
All right, 613. Can we live them all?
No.
Can we receive the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
By doing the works of the law. If you live them perfectly. But we can't. So why did God give the 613 laws? To tell us one thing. I can't do that. So why did God say, all right, Bill, yes, you want to go to heaven? Yes. All right, obey 613. I can't. I need the Spirit, the pneuma, N-P-N-N-U-A, I need the pneuma, and with the pneuma in me, the Spirit of God lives the Word of God inside me. When the Spirit of God lives the Word of God inside me, I have received Him.
Amen.
Now, what does it mean to receive the Holy Spirit? Did you receive the Holy Spirit? It means I take Him in, I live according to His Word, I obey, I live in the fruit of the Spirit, I do what God wants. I have a hunger for God. Let me ask you if you receive the Holy Spirit. You ready? You want a test? Here's the test if you receive the Holy Spirit. Ready? You ready to see if you receive the Holy Spirit? You have a hunger for more. You have a hunger for more of God. Jesus says to us in the Magnificats of His words, in the Sermon on the Mount when He starts, those who hunger and thirst for holiness. Don't you want more?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so the husbands blast the wives in this town. Again? You want more?
Again?
I need more. Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
How many know I'm OD'd on Corinthians? I shoot up every night. Amen? I'm OD'd. And you should see that my family's eyeballs. Oh. Oh, deep. Amen? So did you receive the Holy Spirit? Can you obey this in the Holy Spirit?
No.
Is this going to produce the Holy Spirit? No. Because what am I going to do with the law? I'm going to try to get in. All right, let's see if you're a believer. Do you keep saying I'm going to try?
No.
All right, I have a new campaign starting right now. Don't ever say try again. Right? Number two, don't ever, ever worry ever again. How many are going to pass? It doesn't make you feel better. It makes you miserable. Worrying means you go on your own power. But you and I are men and women of the Spirit, so as I'm saved by grace. I'm saved by grace. Amen?
Amen.
So did you receive the Holy Spirit? Ask the person next to you, did you receive the Holy Spirit? All right, now if we receive the Holy Spirit, you can't go backwards. Amen? Stop going backwards. Now he says to us there, are you so foolish? Now, underline that. How do you get saved? Hear with faith. Do you know what? Listen to me. You know, I've been criticized my whole life. That's the joy of my life, being criticized. Do you know why I go more than 5 minutes? Because I have so much in me. I could preach hours. Yeah, we know.
Yeah.
I want you to know everything. Why? Why do I want to tell you more than 5 minutes? Because the more you hear with faith, the more you can be saved.
Amen.
The more you can grow. Amen?
Amen?
I know I'm under a time limit. I know some of those beady eyes are looking at me. Amen? But Romans 10, 17. You can't be saved without hearing the word of God. Romans 10, 17. You got to hear something. Now, what happens is the preacher gets out to preach. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7. Blessed are those who walk with feet to preach the word of God. Here's what happens. You hear a preaching. Did you all like Fulton Sheen?
Yes.
Was he your favorite preacher? No? Yes? No? Okay. When you hear the word of God, what do you say? Wow, yeah. Yeah. How many of you ever said once, yes, yeah, that's good, yeah. As soon as you start to agree with the word of God, you're on the way to being saved. And then when you say, yes, I believe. When you say from your heart, I believe, you're saved. You have received the Holy Spirit. As some would say, you're a born again Christian. Amen. You accepted Jesus. You accepted the gospel. And that's what I want to do. That's what I'm trying to do here. That's my call. That's why I want, the Lord has given me a vision for Bible study for this whole area. I believe everybody should get their mind renewed by the word of God. And we can't stop now. I want you saved. I want you in heaven. I because what's coming down the pike, what the Lord has shown me down the pike is not good. So what do I got to do? I got to keep preaching the word of God. And when you hear it, you're like, yes, yes, yes. And then when you say yes to it, the power of the Holy Spirit takes over, opens your eyes, gives you brand new vision, and you're not as bad as when you first walked in. You have hope. So did you receive the Holy Spirit? So if you underline that hearing, put in there Romans 10, 17. Next, are you so foolish? Now, every time Paul asks a question, this is called rhetorical thinking. Everybody say rhetorical.
Rhetorical
thinking is, this is the way they taught in the first century, rhetorical. Remember when Jesus was only 12 in Luke chapter 2, verse 41. Do you know what Jesus was doing? Besides driving his parents nuts, what was he doing? Jesus, how many know right there Jesus was doing rhetorical preaching? You know what they would do? They would say to Jesus, all right, we got a question for you. And Jesus would give them the answer, and they went, whoa. I went to Staten Island, and I met a little kid like this, and I went, whoa.
A little Jewish kid?
No, he was Catholic. Usher, would you escort that woman out? No, he was a Catholic, and then he went into all this deep theology and went, whoa! Under my breath, please don't let him ask me another question. Whoa! I would ask questions, and he would say, well, you know. He would go, I said, you're only 10, cool it, live your life, will you? And after he was done, I just went like this. And when I saw his hand raised, okay, over here! So this is called rhetorical. So Paul's asking rhetorical questions. So he doesn't want information out of you, but he wants you to think where you are right now. Are you that foolish? Are you morons? Are you morose? Isn't that a great Greek word? Have you begun with the Spirit? Yes, we got the Spirit. We got the Holy Spirit. We received the Spirit. We're born again. We're saved by Jesus Christ. But what happens to mostly all of us here? We go back to where we were. And then he says, you've begun in the Spirit. How do you say Spirit, everybody? The pneuma. Everybody say pneuma.
Pneuma.
But we go back into the flesh. How do you say flesh? Sarx.
Sarx.
Does that word sound ominous?
Sarx.
We go back to the sarx. We go back to the flesh. What's the flesh? That which kills you. You know, as I was sharing with you yesterday, a lot of, you know, how many know we could take over the world with the gospel? but we got a problem in Houston. There's a problem in church, Houston. We can't agree on what we believe in. I told the people yesterday, if we only got together to believe together, and that's why Jesus couldn't do any miracles there, because nobody believed in the same thing. Because we're in the flesh. We think it should be this, we think it should be that. You can't be saved that way. So, you began by being redeemed. We're in the Spirit, yes, Holy Spirit, come. I am saved by grace alone. By the way, I'm very Catholic. But now, what do I go back? I go back to, oh, I better try to earn it. Oh, I better try to do this. I'm not good enough. Poor me. Why me? How come me? I want, when the Lord calls you one day, I want you to go out in a blaze of glory. How many want to go into a blaze of glory?
Amen.
Order today. Lord, I want to go out in a blaze of glory. Amen. I've been at some people's deathbeds and they went out in a blaze. Amen. And one guy popped up and I went, whoa. And he says, the angels are coming. I'm leaving. I said, well, goodbye to you. And what happened? Off we go to the wild. And you know what his 2 cents says? We have never seen such a blessed, blessed death. And so I go to bed every night. They're coming for me. They're coming for me. Oh, by the way, when you go to bed tonight, practice. Amen. So, we've got the Spirit. How can we go back to the flesh? What's the flesh? It's this stuff. Don't go back. How many know? The problem with us is our sarks. Everybody say sarks.
Sarks.
And our pneuma live close in proximity. And because they live so close to each other, they catch each other's cold. So if the Spirit hiccups, and you, how many ever had a spirit moment with God, like, oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, and the flesh goes, oh, oh, that's called your husband, by the way, oh, 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 okay, and then all of a sudden, because your flesh doesn't get pampered to, oh, anytime your husband's upset with you, it's because he's not being focused upon. That's why he's upset, right? And then, because they live close together, amen, day after day, week after, and then when the Spirit takes over, the flesh doesn't win. But when the flesh kicks in, we don't need this, we gotta do that, the Spirit suffers, amen? God and me have this thing, he's my bud. Okay, we don't really need that. And guess what happens? The flesh wins then, right? So, Paul says there, is this good stuff? Have you begun with the Spirit? Are you now ending with the flesh, the sarks? Are you going back to pagan ways? Look at verse number 4. Did you experience many things in vain? Now, remember we did Corinthians. Are you receiving the gospel in vain? In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, you know what vanity is? You know, vanity is this. Elizabeth I had an inch thick makeup when she died. They had to cake it off of her. Amen? How many had mascara? Remember it used to drip? Remember you cried? I knew. I was preaching once in Metuchen. One lady said, Father Bill, you are definitely a different priest. I said, praise God. And she started crying because the whole family accepted Christ. And I never prayed over my daughter in my life. And she started crying, and I knew something was happening. The eyelashes were going all the way down. And the eyelashes were right here by the. I said, Madam, are you growing? Amen. And the streaks were coming down. I knew the Holy Spirit was touching her. Amen? Amen? So, so now, this is called vain. Amen? You're so vain. You think this song is about you, don't you, don't you, don't you, don't you, don't you? Now, here's what vanity means. From the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, when you become vain. Vanity means that you are empty inside. Right? Vanity, you are empty inside. That you're looking for filler inners. And anything going to fill you in? Nothing. So if you begin in the spirit and you go back to the sarx, you pick up vanity. You pick up vanity, and guess what happens to you? You're empty, 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 empty. And you're, what are you going to do? For the rest of your life, you're going to look at filler inners. But who's the filler inner? When I have the spirit, as we just said, you got a hunger and thirst, I get more, I get more, I get more. See, that's why I can never settle on a 5-minute homily. I need more. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, isn't this good stuff?
Yeah.
And then he goes on to say there, verse 5, does he who supplies the Spirit to you, who supplies the Spirit? God does, doesn't he? And works works miracles among you, do so by the works of the law. Do you see the miracles now? Jesus couldn't do a miracle yesterday. You know why he couldn't do the miracle? There's no faith there. Because you know what they were doing? They obscured the obvious. What do they want to do? Shoot the messenger. How many of you want to shoot the messenger? And you know what I want to say? Get me in your houses. Get you. I'll talk to these husbands of yours. I'll make them take me out to dinner too. They are shooting the messenger. They can't see the obvious. This is real life stakes. Heaven and hell is real. Amen?
Amen.
This is real. What are you messing around with your eternity? In a few short years, you're not here. I'm already writing your funeral homilies. who supplies the Spirit to you? Works miracles among you. Miracles, if you underline that, miracles are only worked for God to prove to you that He's going to touch the entire person of you. God doesn't do miracles just so, whee! So God comes and He gives it, let me blow my spirit upon you. Yes, come Holy Spirit. You want to see miracles? Do you know why you haven't seen any? Because you have blocked God from showing you how He can touch your whole person. Miracles are never planned. Never. You know, people call me up, I pray with them, whatever. And I've seen a lot of miracles here. But guess what? The greatest miracle is a person to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the greatest miracle there is. When I know their name is written on the Lamb's Book of Life, I am rejoicing. That's the greatest moment of all of my life. That's why it's worth, you know what my goal for the rest of my life is? To pray with one more person, and it might even be in this wonderful town, to know Jesus Christ. And if I can pray with that one person to know Jesus Christ, the rest of my life is worth it. Amen? That's the miracle. Do you understand miracles?
Yeah.
And by the way, another thought about miracles. When the Holy Spirit does miracles, they're always instantly incomplete. Healings are part of the way. Miracles are all the way. Jesus never did. All right, take 2 Tylenol. I'll see you tomorrow morning. No, Jesus did the full thing. Jesus did instant. Jesus did the complete work. That's why He says to us in 1 John, then my joy will be complete. Did you understand what that means now? When you have the Holy Spirit inside you, when you have the power of the working of God in your life, and you all do, you have God in your heart, you have the Holy Spirit, then you can say, I have joy in my life. But I'm looking at these people. They don't look too good some Sundays. They look like time to make the donuts. I'm not judging, just observing. Now, He works miracles among you by the works of the law. Now, the works of the law, how many laws are there?
Six.
You can't be saved that way. Paul had a problem in Romans 7. You know what Paul did? You know what he said in Hebrew? That's Romans 7. He says, I can't do this. And he was a super brain. And he studied the Bible. He had them all memorized. My rabbi friend has all 613 laws memorized. He knows when he violates law number 212. How many would like to live there? Oh, there's 212. Oh. 47. Yep, I did that one too. So you know what he has to? You know what he has to do every morning? You think you have a heart? He has to take each food item and bless it, lift it up differently.
Really?
How many know you would never eat? How long would Thanksgiving take? Three hours. Can we eat yet? Amen? Are you getting this? So how many want to live like that? Jesus came to free us from that. Now, underline the next, see it again there. Are you doing so by the works of the law? You want to live like this? Or hearing with faith? There's Romans 10:17. You got to hear about it with what? Faith. You got to say, I believe. You cannot say, I believe in God. If you say, I believe in God, you'll still not be saved. You got to say, I believe God. Do you see the difference? You see all those people upstairs? They believe in God. You see most of the people on the streets? They believe in God. Look at this place. How many would like to see a powerful renewal of the Spirit here? When people start saying, I believe God. And I told you, the Lord could use me this Sunday if I can get everybody together in one church standing. Everybody join hands and proclaim with your heart, Jesus Christ is Lord. A revival will break out. But we don't own that. We don't own that. The next line he says there, verses 6 down through 9. He goes back to Father Abraham had many sons. Now, Abraham, the word means the father of the many. Abraham lived about 1850 BC. He was 75 years old when he got his call. By the way, the Orthodox Jews believe he went through the fire too, like Daniel. He came from a town called Ur. How many ever heard Ur? You know what Ur means? You know what the reason why the Jews believe that? You know what Ur means? Fire. He came from Ur. And you know what happened when he got his call? The Jews believe is that that God called him to start marching out. And they took Sarah. Honey. Yes, honey. We're moving. Where are we going? Milltown? No. We're moving. And what did Sarah say? Honey, how do we know when we get there? Well, no. God will tell us when we arrive. How many would like to have that kind of faith? Start marching. Where? And when God tests you and puts you, then you know when you arrive when God tells you you're there. God wants to take us to the promised land. And that's our journey to glory. We know by faith in Jesus Christ, we're all glory bound, right? And how many know when you arrive there, when you see it? How many know right now you're on the way to heaven? You know you're on the way to heaven because you know the enemies that are facing you have no power over you. The moment you believe that the enemies around you have no power, you know you're on the way to heaven. If you don't know that, the enemies are taking over you. From our addictions to what the world's doing, worries and fears and anxieties, then the world has a grip on you. He says there, thus Abraham believed God, underline that, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. That's Genesis 15:6. This is Paul's second favorite book of the Bible. What are Paul's favorite books of the Bible? He carried scrolls around. Number one was Isaiah. Number two was Genesis. Also number three was Deuteronomy, if you want the next book. He carried these scrolls around all the time. So what did he have to do? And to establish his faith, he has to give faith. Now, there's only one time in the entire Old Testament the Bible says you got to have faith. Only one time. You've got to have faith in God. Do you all have faith?
Yes.
Do you believe God or believe in God?
Believe God.
Okay, now, how many know you're all raised to believe in God? Did that really help you? Sometimes. But how many would like to believe God? That means you make a declaration that God's going to show up. And guess what? When you call upon his name, and how many know if you believe like that, God is obligated to do something? How many like to live under God's obligation to really see the power of God work in your life? Wow, because he's God. He says he'll do that. And in Genesis 22, verse 14, he says he's going to provide the lamb. So he's obligated to do that because he said he would. I like to live under that kind of power, right?
Yes.
I want to know his word so I can live under that power. So now, put in there Genesis chapter 15. So what does Paul have to do? Let me give you scripture. Paul says, let me give you the word. Let me give you the word, the Torah. The very first book in the Bereshit, in the beginning. Genesis 15. So this is the first time believing. Now, in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, we have the first time in the Bible that says you got to believe. I can't make you believe. The only thing that I want to do on Sundays and every day is share the word of God with you. But guess what? Some people don't want to hear it. But I still got to preach it no matter what, in season and out of season. I got to share the word of God. So what did Abraham do? In Genesis chapter 15, if you go to Genesis 15, God did something very, very strange. He took an alliance and he told Abraham he had to cut animals. How many like to cut animals? And the animals were not cut this way. They were cut all the way down. And he had to put one piece over here and one piece over here. How many think that would be a bloody mess?
Yeah.
And then God put him in what is called a tardema. He went into a supersonic dream. He could not open his eyes. And he saw the power of God pass through with a torch. And it made a figure eight. When it made the figure eight, it came around to lock him in to what God was doing. And God says, look, Abraham. This is loose Hebrew, okay? God says, look, Abraham. You can believe in me, and you can go on my unilateral commitment to you. Because how many here would like to sign a contract with God? I will never sin again. How many want to sign that contract? I will never sin again. I wouldn't sign it. Because I know my weaknesses. I need a Savior. I said, Lord, I'll only sign it if it's in the blood of Jesus. And so here comes the figure eight. And now I need to rely on one. All God. Grace alone. Oh God. I can't do it. I'm too weak. You know, even with all the Bible studies and the Greek and the Hebrew and all the background that I've studied, all the years, all the degrees that I have, I can't do it. I can't do it. I need a Savior. I need Jesus. Will someone please help me? I need Jesus. And so God made the figure eight. He says, I'll lock you in. Now here's what you do, Bill. I said, yes, Lord, what do I do now? He says, you can't sign a contract with me because you can't do it. So what am I going to do? So God, what are you going to do? I can't do it. He says, lean on me with your whole life. Give me your whole life and everything will be on me. And so when I lean everything on him, I'm on the unilateral commitment that God makes to us. And that's my faith. That's my faith. How many think that's a good deal? Yes. I say, good deal, good deal. I'll take it. And then I don't have to go through my life worrying whether I'm going to make it, whether I hope I get in. Do you see your false humility coming in? Now, this is God. Anybody have kids? If your kids say, if it be your will, can I have dinner? How many of your kids have never politely said, Mom, can I have money? They said, Mom, need money. Right? Philippians 4:19, God will supply all of our needs, won't he? So how many like hearing all those good things? But we've got to learn how to appropriate them spiritually. We can appropriate them spiritually and we can be set free. We can be mighty men and women of God even more than we are already. So now comes Abraham. If you underline that, Genesis 15:6. So Paul uses a scripture. Paul uses a scripture. This is good stuff. Amen?
Amen.
That it's reckoned to him as righteousness. Reckoned to him. Everybody circle the word reckon. That's a banking term. How many would like $10,000 more in your bank? Anybody?
Amen.
Oh, come on. I know you want $10,000 more. Amen? Wouldn't you feel a little better with $10,000 more? You want something reckoned into your account. I want, in my account, I want God's life in my account. I want things reckoned in my account because I'm going to stand in front of God. And what am I going to put in the account? Diakosune. It's a big long word, isn't it? Inside diakosune. Everybody say diakosune.
Yes.
That's the life of God living his life through me. I've got to say to him, Jesus, be my Lord and be my Savior. Jesus, live your life through me. So when you see me acting really great in the spirit, it's all God. I can't even take credit for it. I can't polish myself tonight. It's not me. It's God. It's his righteousness. It's the power of the spirit. So I'm not going to go back to say, all right, I've got to try to earn it. When I start polishing myself tonight, then I'm going back in the flesh. When I start, put up the applause sign, applause, applause, I'm back in the flesh. When I walk the humility path with Jesus on the way to Calvary, then I'm in the spirit.
Amen.
Then I'm in the spirit. So Abraham, he had to go through Ur, he had to go through the fire. He had to so trust God. He had to so trust God that he could walk that path. Amen. Next, so you see that men of faith who are sons of Abraham. Now underline that, we are all sons of Abraham because the first time in the Bible, it says belief. Now, what's the first expression of belief? I told you before, in Exodus chapter 14, verse 31. When do you really begin to believe? You only begin to believe when your enemy is destroyed. I was called here by a parishioner. He had heart problems. And all of a sudden I walk in, and the kids are, the older kids go, oh yeah, Father Bell's here, all right, what's it gonna go, all right, what's it gonna go? And I said, hello, hello. And I always pray people to accept Jesus, their Lord and God and their Savior, all right. And then I prayed over him, all right, what they're gonna do? I said, God's gonna do something great in his life right now. Okay, yeah, sure, right, all right, goodbye. And guess what happened? Totally healed.
Wow, praise God.
And I see them at 12 o'clock mass every day. They're like, wow. Mm. And now they like me. They take me out for dinner. But that's not why. The power of God showed up. Amen.
Yeah, amen.
The power of God and the Spirit showed up. Amen.
Yeah.
So underline that verse 7. We're all sons of God. So this is the basis of your faith. That's why we say Father Abraham. And notice, this is so exciting. This is so exciting. Did I tell you this is exciting? This is the first time in the Bible, Genesis 15:6, that the gospel has been preached and received. This is the first time the gospel is preached and received. Father Abraham, that's why we say we're sons, Christians, Jews, and Muslims always seek him. The Muslims call him Abraham. Okay? The Jews call him Abraham, and a great respect for him. And he had the 10 trials. So we are sons and daughters of Abraham in this context. Faith. By faith. And so put a little note there. And this is the context. By faith we're saved. Amen? Amen. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8. Next. And the scripture, underline verse 8. Foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preach the gospel beforehand to Abraham. Underline that. Right in the page of Genesis 15:6. Abraham heard the gospel. Remember after Jesus died, he was buried? What happened to Jesus? He descended into the place of the dead. The Jews believe, the first three people, this is what the Jews believe right now. The Jews believe that the first three people who are going to be resurrected are Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Of course, Christians believe the first resurrected is Jesus. John 11:25. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And you and I will follow Jesus into glory one day. But now Abraham believed God. And what happened to him? He's going to be part of the resurrection. So put a little note there. The first to hear the gospel was Abram. Why? Because he had the element that's required. Faith. Faith. And then after he got faith, then he became circumcised at the age of 99. How many know that'll cause you to sing in high C for a while? And then when he got circumcised in Genesis 18, he had three visitors. Three angels visit him. How many know he was sore? That's why he couldn't move. How many know he was recovering at the age of 99? And that's the time that when he was recovering, when he was circumcised. Then God said, you're going to have a son, Yitzhak. And Sarah, she was a gorgeous looking woman. Whoa, was she gorgeous. She wore Gloria Vanderbilt jeans. She was gorgeous. And Sarah heard the news. She was spying. You know, she saw these three guys walk into Abraham's tent, and they're doing a good Jewish thing called the pakad. The pakad is the visit. Who are these visitors? So Sarah starts listening. Abram, yes. Angel, yes. You're going to have a little piccolo bambino. Piccolo. Piccolo. Piccolo, piccolo, piccolo. Amen? And then she started going hysterical with laughter. 9 months later, whoop. There you are. She had a little piccolo bambino. She couldn't believe it. The seed was there. Because the seed of conversion back then was having children. Now the seed of conversion is the mouth. The mouth proclaiming Jesus Christ. Why do I talk more? Because I got a mouth. I got to see as many as I can to come into the knowledge of the truth and know the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you saved. I want you to go to heaven. Things are not good. Jesus Christ is our only hope. Next he says there, underline that, in you all the nations will be blessed. That's why, that's in Genesis chapter 12, if you put in Genesis 12 there. Verses 1 to 3. Please never, never, never curse Jewish people. Don't curse anybody. Remember, if you curse people, you commit a serious sin. Don't ever lay a curse on anybody. Amen? Don't ever wish any... The only thing you curse is the evil that people do. Don't ever curse the person. Amen? Everybody passing? Verse number 9. So then you who are men of faith are blessed with Abraham who had faith. So this is where the faith is born. Now, in John chapter 14, Jesus says to us, do not worry. And this is when he's walking out to Calvary. This is when he's going to Gethsemane. Jesus says to us very clearly, brothers and sisters, Jesus says, listen, he says, have faith in God and faith in me. Jesus says to the woman in today's gospel, daughter, your faith has saved you. The word in Greek is sozo, S-O-Z-O. It means you're totally healed, S-O-Z-O, sozo. And you notice what Jesus did. There's only one person in the Bible Jesus calls daughter. And guess where that comes from? It comes from a love scene in Psalm 45. There's only once, daughter Israel. Daughter, come into the marriage. And so what is Jesus saying to this woman who's reaching out? Daughter! Wow. Isn't that beautiful? Your faith has saved you. Not only are you healed, that was secondary. Your whole being has responded. You're saved. You're sozo. You're totally, your inside, your emotions. Everything about you is saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. How many want that kind of salvation? This is good stuff. This is really good. And then he goes on to say, look at verse 10. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. If I try to obey the law, I can't do it. So what do I find out? I'm cursed. I can't do it. Paul was battling his head against the proverbial wall. The law produces what I can't do. God has a demand. You see, if God was an Alexahente, the demanding one, what kind of life would you leave? And by the way, you are being shoveled down your throat with this false gospel. God loves everybody. We are all going to heaven. And you know you leave church saying, I'm going to heaven. But you live a lifestyle like hell. You curse. And you think because you wind up in a church on a Saturday night or a Sunday, you're going to heaven? Forget about it, we say in Brooklyn. You need to meet the demands. And the demands were the law, but I can't live it. So what do you got to scream out inside of you? I need a Savior. And so, by grace, so what does this do when I look at this? I am under a curse. Because God says, Bill, I have a demand on you. Live 613 laws, and you can come in. I'm like, all right, I can get by a few days, maybe a few years, maybe 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, thinking I'm okay. But how many know the older you get, you start thinking a little bit, what's this life all about? And then if I make it to 95 and I'm on my rocking chair, what did I do with my life? Where am I going? I have no answers to that. I'm under a curse. And so if you underline that there with me. And by the way, what's the curse? There's three curses there. How many know nobody here is cursed? Turn to the person next to you, you're not cursed. Even though you feel like you did. Even though you feel like you married Godzilla by accident. I know you're that. Now, remember, you gotta get this. Holy Spirit, help you get this. The curse is this. In Genesis 3:19, God says to Adam, cursed are you with your ground. How many ever had a bad day at work? Nobody? Yes. How many ever had one of those issues? I want to quit. I was just talking to my brother on the phone last week. He says, I can't stand this job. I said, quit. He says, no, I need the money. I said, okay. Amen? Now, what are your curses? How many want to be curse-free? Cursed free. Now, Genesis 3:19. Adam, cursed are you with thorns and thistles. That's why on Jesus' head are the thorns. And by the way, it's not that little... You see the kids driving their helmets on their bicycles? That's the thorn. You're not cursed. Nobody here. Now, what are your curses? Your sin. Right? How many keep sinning? Nobody? Very good. You're all glowing in the dark. Great. What's the second part of your curse? Sickness. Anybody getting sick? When I go to the doctor's office, I was leaving the doctor's office, and I knew people were outside waiting. I said to Henry, I said, look, Henry, I got 3 weeks left. And they're all screaming, they all ran out of the office. And they said, well, what do you think this happens? I said, I don't believe in it. And the doctor says, you're really strange. I said, yes, I don't believe in it. I'm not under a curse. Sin, I'm free. My sins are all forgiven. They were nailed to the cross, Galatians 2. Second, I don't have what? Sickness. I'm not going to let sickness destroy this life. Third, what's the third thing? Satan. Those are the three S's. You got the three S's? Sin. Are you all forgiven your sins? Will you be forever sick? No. What is the ultimate result of our sin? There's going to be an ultimate penalty when we go public. Remember we just talked about public? The ultimate penalty is what? It's called the second death. It's not the first death. We're all going to die. The book of Revelation says the second death. When you die and you're never saved. Amen? It's called the second death. Amen? That's the ultimate worst. So what am I saved from? I'm saved from sin. I'm saved from Satan. The evil one can't destroy me. Those are the three. That's your curse. How many want to get out of the curse right now? I want to be cursed free. That's what the cross has done for me. How many know that's your salvation? That's life in the Spirit. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? Now, how do I know that we receive the Holy Spirit? Because you start thinking like this. Amen? If you go around living the other way, poor me, why me, and you start to have stinking thinking, it doesn't look like you received the Holy Spirit too well, does it? Okay, are you getting this?
Yes.
Good stuff. Now, underline verse 10. Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law. So guess what happens? What happens to the Jewish people who are hearing this word? You're cursed! I told you, the rabbi said to me, you have it easy! I said, to come to this point was not easy. It was the work of God. It was the work of the Father. As Peter said, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. That was the work of the Father. That, praise God, in my life I allowed to listen. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So if you just want to follow this book of the laws and try to live all those laws, you're cursed. What's the worst curse in your life? When you wake up one day and say, I can't do this. I can't do this anymore. How do you feel weak and impotent when you say, I can't do this anymore? Remember, you used to be young and you'd do everything? I saw one kid today sitting on the floor like, you know how the little kids twist their legs and everything else? I said, I can't even get down there anymore. I try getting up. I would just watch them. Monica could. Monica was in all kind of positions. And so that's the law. That's the law. Amen? Do you understand this? Do you understand that we need help? And so what's my... You want to contact, I told you, the Holy Spirit? Contacting the Holy Spirit. It's my favorite word. Cursed be everyone who does not. Look at verse 11. Now is the evidence that no man is justified before the law. Justified means you can stand in front of God. Justification by faith. Do Catholics believe in justification by faith? Absolutely. That means you can stand in front of God, not because of what you've done, because of what He has done through you. Open your door and give Him permission to come in. You're justified, just as if you've never committed a sin. How many know when you go to heaven, you're going to be sin-free? You're going to be looking glowing. Just as if you never sinned. Just that we didn't been through this valley of the shadow of the darkness. How many want to live life like that? That's what we receive right now when we see faith. Justification by faith. Romans 3, Romans 4, Romans 5. We are justified by faith. That means justified is a big word. I can stand in front of God. How many want to stand in front of God and hear those words? Welcome. Because God does not ever say to you now, you're a good person. How many think God says you're a good person? So every time I hear somebody preaching, oh, they're so good, you're so good, I'm like, that's not really biblical. I know the preacher is trying to encourage you, but be careful. Without, we are justified. Even the good Saint Joseph, what we call him, good Saint Joseph, he was never called good in the Bible. You never find one expression, he's called good. Justified by faith. Justified. I can stand in front of God. How many want to stand in front of God and then hear, well done, good and faithful servant? And you'll only hear, well done, good and faithful servant, on that day. You'll never hear God call you good now. Oh, we call at the funeral parlor, oh, there's Joe. He was such a good person. He's so good. Oh, and what do you say? And how many funeral parlors are the loudest place in the world? And I'm up there trying to lead prayers. All right, everybody, shut up and sit down and listen to the praising. And I was doing one in your place over there. So I was doing one place, and one guy continued to talk. Holy Spirit, knock the guy out to the left. Amen. They just talk. What are they talking about? The guy's dead. Oh, I haven't seen you in 100 years. Yeah, funny. Joe finally dies and gets us together. Yeah, it's good to see you. How are the kids? How's the dog? Oh, great. Oh, we died too. Okay. I went to a funeral way up in North Jersey. And one of my dearest friend's mother died. Adam said, John, I'm really sorry. And I'm looking in the coffin, and there's her name was Christian. She's a beautiful woman of God. And someone says, did you hear the news? You know, how many know you get older, you speak louder. Did you hear the news? I said,
so loud.
It was so loud. Did you hear the news? John, wait a minute, I gotta hear this. What's the news? Mary Raycheck. I said, how's Mary? Who the heck is Mary? I don't know. She won the bingo. I said, oh, good for her. I shook with laughter. Here's the dead body, and I ran out of the funeral parlor. I said, I cannot. Mary, so to this day, I know Mary Raycheck won the bingo. Is that amen? Mary, good old Mary. Mary probably went to be with God anyway. But that's not what a funeral parlor is about. Now, let's start a new trend here. What are we going to funeral parlors and talk about? Faith.
Yeah.
Faith. Yeah. Amen? I walked into a funeral parlor in Clark. Did you ever hear Clark?
Yes.
And I did an altar call. All right, I want you to pray with me and accept Jesus, your Lord and Savior. Are you ready for your judgment day? They went, I said, oh, I'm going to enjoy this. This is going to be fun. And they were all like, and I love what you women do to your husbands. And do you do that to your husband? Okay. And I said, now, someone here is going next. Where are you? They pray with me, accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And the mascara started dripping. But they were no longer crying for Joe in the box. They're crying for themselves. So they came up to me and they said, you are the most unusual priest I've ever met in my life. And they said, it's beautiful having Christ in your heart. I said, yes. I did another wake, about a month later. Are you Father Bill? Yes. You are the strangest person I've ever met. When's your next wake? I'm coming. Amen. Amen. Oh, by the way, I'm doing one tomorrow if you want to come. Okay, let's do it. Amen. So, everybody get this now. Then notice one thing, and I'm done. This is so good. Is this good stuff?
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Now, let me show you something. You're the only ones on your block that know this. You gotta get the background, alright? Hashem Miami, you get in the background? Now watch this background. Paul says there, I'm giving you Genesis 15, 6. They didn't have the numbers like that. Okay? He says, I'm giving you Leviticus, right? Now, here's the good insight. This is so good. This is worth the price of admission. When the Jews preached to you, they give you what is called the Torah. Everybody know the Torah? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And the Jews have to give you another section of the Bible called the Haftorah, which are the prophets. So what was Paul giving them? Paul was giving them a full synagogue service on salvation in Jesus Christ. So what did he do? What's the Haftorah? The prophets. Okay? And so what he says, I give you the Torah. That's the first reading. He opens the scroll. And then he says, now let me give you the Haftorah. And then he does something. He picks out Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. So he gives them. Because every single reading, like how many heard the reading yesterday? It has to match the gospel reading. And so what was Paul doing? I give you our initial reading as Jews, and then I match it up with the prophets. And this is the only time in the Bible where it mentions the word faith. And he pulls Jesus right smack in the center. And so he takes the whole Torah from the beginning to the end of the scriptures, and he says, you know what this book is about? It's about Jesus. Wow. And guess what? The Galatians said, how can I go back to the flesh after this? We live by faith. Sister Hashem.
So when he tells them in Leviticus, keep my decrees and laws, for the man who obeys them will live by them. I am the law. He's saying you can only do this through Jesus.
You can't do it by yourself. Do you think you got the point, brothers and sisters?
Yeah.
Now, next week we're going on a great journey. We're going to Mount Sinai, and then we're gonna show you something absolutely spectacular. There's something that happened on Mount Sinai you never heard about, but it's right here in the book. You heard about it, Sinai, but you didn't realize something happened that you never heard about before, even though you heard about it and read about it, but nobody ever told you it was in there. Something will astound you next week that happened at Sinai. You never knew it happened. Stay tuned next week. Does everybody know Jesus, your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Are you sure? I want you in glory. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Father, we just thank you for the word of God. We thank you that we're saved by faith in Jesus Christ. Bless this church and bless this town with a new renewal and revival of the Holy Spirit. Bless our great group of all the hundreds of kids that are coming through our doors on a weekly basis to hear the gospel, especially this week in Bible camp. And Lord, let the kids know the Lord and Savior and get their good parents. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
Good stuff?
Yes. Good stuff.